الحمد لله الحمد لله خالق الوجود من العدم وجاعل النور من الظلم ومخرج الصبر من الألم فملقي التوبة على الندم فنشكره على المصائب كما نشكره على النعم ونصلي على رسوله الأكرم ذي الشرف الأشم والنور الأتم والكتاب المحكم وكمال النبيين والخاتم سيد ولد آدم الذي بشر به عيسى بن مريم ودعا لبعثته إبراهيم عليه السلام حين كان يرفع قواعد بيت الله المحرم فصلى الله عليه وسلم وعلى أتباعه خير الأمم الذين بارك الله بهم كافة الناس العرب منهم والعجم فالحمد لله الذي لم يتخذ ولدا ولم يكن له شريك في الملك ولم يكن له ولي من الذل وكبره تكبيرا والحمد لله الذي أنزل على عبده الكتاب ولم يجعل له عوجا والحمد لله الذي نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له ونشهد أن محمدا عبد الله ورسوله أرسله الله تعالى بالهدى ودين الحق ليظهره على الدين كله وكفى بالله شهيدا فصلى الله عليه وسلم تسليما كثيرا كثيرا أما بعد فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وإن شر الأمور محدثاتها وإن كل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار قال الله عز وجل في كتابه الكريم بعد أن أقول أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم قال ربي إني ظلمت نفسي فاغفر لي فغفر له إنه هو الغفور الرحيم قال ربي بما أنعمت علي فلن أكون ظهيرا للمجرمين ربي اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي اللهم ثبتنا عند الموت بلا إله إلا الله واللهم اجعلنا من الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر آمين يا رب العالمين A lot of people write to me on different platforms and share some of the things that they're experiencing. And a common concern that several people have, in fact, shared with me recently has been that, you know, at some point in their life, they realized that they messed up. So they were living a life where they didn't really care about the consequences of their actions. And they were, you know, kind of doing whatever makes them happy. And in doing so, they caused a lot of damage to a lot of people. So not only is it a violation of what Allah considers wrong, so they didn't care about what's halal and haram, that was one issue. But the other issue is they hurt a lot of people along the way, right? And with no cause or concern, no looking back, right? You're just going to do what I'm going to do. And eventually all of that catches up with you. And then one day you kind of, by some miracle of Allah, you wake up and you realize, oh my God, what have I done? I'm this horrible human being, and I've wronged so many people, I've hurt so many people, I've said so many terrible things, and I've completely disregarded Allah Azza wa Jalla. And so the realization of that, it can be a very heavy one. And a person can then start questioning, how could I be so evil, or so wrong, or so heedless, and so careless, and so reckless, and so selfish, and so arrogant, you name it, how could I be all those things for so long? How come I didn't wake up before? And the guilt of that starts eating away at a person when they have that realization. Now before I carry on with this scenario, I want you to know that Shaitan has a strategy for every phase of our failure. Like he doesn't cause a human being to fail in one step. He wants the human being to fail in subtle stages. You know how they did this example a long time ago? Well, it's animal cruelty really, but if you took a frog and you threw it in boiling water, it would jump right out. But if you put a frog and you boil the water slowly, heat the water slowly, it wouldn't even realize that it's slowly marching towards its death, and it would actually die without ever jumping out, right? So there's a slow progression in which he's poisoning you, or he's boiling you really, slowly but surely before you get to the point of no return, right? So in the beginning, his job is to make something really bad seem not so bad. So even if it's a major sin and it's something totally evil, he'll say, come on, you're just human. Everybody does this. It's okay, you just slipped up. It's okay, you're going through a lot, so it's understandable. Like he'll He'll pat you on the back. He'll support you. He'll comfort you. He'll try to give you these thoughts in your head that what you're doing is not that bad. Or maybe just don't think about it. He says, why can't you just be happy for once? Just be happy. Pick the drink up. It's okay. You know, you're going in so much stress. This is the least you could do. You know, it's their fault. It's your uncle's fault. It's your friend's fault. It's her fault. It's his fault that they made you do this. It's not you. It's somebody else who made you do this. So he feeds you all this stuff where it's not me. It's somebody else who's making me do it. You know, so it's their fault. It's really not mine. They're the reason that I'm falling into this haram or this evil. And this is why I'm lashing out. And this is the way I am the way I am. And so once he does that, then it becomes easy for you and me to take whatever wrong action we were going to take. If we fall into that trap, if you fall into that kind of thinking, because honestly, the real danger isn't the wrong action. The real danger is the thinking that happens before that action. The Quran gave us guidance on our thoughts. This is why the Quran emphasizes a lot, أَفَلَا تَعْقِلُونَ. Don't you use your intellect. The thought process that we engage in every day, the thoughts that we have every day, Allah guides them. Because if you don't guide your thoughts, the next thing that will happen is misguided behavior. The actions will be misguided. So this thought process, the shaitan is very good at filling your head with this thought process, and you can accept it or reject it, just like, you know, junk mail, or just like, you know, ads that you don't want to watch. You can choose to click on it and engage, or you can ignore it. The thought will come, but you have to have the ability, and I have to have the ability to dismiss that thought, to do away with that thought. But if you don't do away with that thought, and that scenario is, okay, you know what, it's not that big of a deal, it's somebody else's fault, and you and I fall into the wrong trap. We end up doing the wrong thing. Then, the next thing that happens is one of two. Shaitan has a, you know, scenarios. You know, in military strategy, they say we're going to make this attack. If A happens, then we'll have this strategy. If B happens, we'll have this strategy. So Shaitan knows that not all human beings respond to failure or sin the same way. Some people fall into sin, and then they become addicted to sin, and they keep on doing it. So he's like, well, this guy's on autopilot, so I don't have to worry about this anymore. He's doing my job for me. She's doing my job for me, so she can just carry on, right? There are other people who do sins continuously, but at one point or another, they wake up. And this is a problem for Shaitan. This is a real problem for him. Why? Because this person was paving their way towards failure, so they can meet Allah Azza wa Jalla in loss, and now all of a sudden they've woken up and they feel bad about what they did. This is not a good thing. This is the first sign that this person wants to return back to Allah. So what does he do with this person? What is Shaitan going to do with this man or woman who decided to wake up, or who Allah put something in their heart and they woke up and they feel horrible? Well, Shaitan has a plan B and C. And his plan B is to now instill you with hopelessness. Now he can tell you, hey, you messed up so much. You're such a terrible human being. Look at all the people you hurt. Look at all these years you've been doing these sins. There's no worse person than you. Why would Allah listen to you? Why would He ever guide you? In fact, you're already in hell. You deserve hell already. And you deserve to be in this mental torture so long as you're alive. I don't even know why you're still alive. These are the thoughts that fill in your head. Regret over your sin, which is actually, spiritually speaking, a healthy thing. Iblis can turn that into an unhealthy thing. He can turn that into an overwhelming sense of, Allah will never forgive me. Oh, and then you have this attitude. If you talk to somebody, you say, you know, I feel like Allah will never forgive me. No, why wouldn't Allah forgive you? Oh, you don't know what I've done. Oh, it's so bad. It's so bad. If you knew, you would know that. Even you would tell me you're going to hell. So this thought process is the next success of Shaitan. Why? Because Shaitan is the master of hopelessness. So one in the before your sin, he wants to make you think it's no big deal. After your sin is done, he wants to convince you it's too big of a deal, Allah will never forgive you. There's no hope for you, right? So, and then he can get somebody trapped in that, and a person can start hating themselves, being miserable, and by the way, misery, hating yourself, crushing yourself, yeah, and having this kind of viral negativity that's inside you, it spreads to the people around you too. It doesn't just stay with you, right? He loves this. This is what he absolutely loves. So now if a person has fallen into that trap, what does the Qur'an do to remedy this? The Quran has lots of remedies for it. But what I want to share with you today is, as a reminder, the stories that Allah tells us in the Quran, you all know they're not just stories, right? They're actually, these are case studies. It's the same Rabb that was the Rabb of Adam alayhi salam, that's my Rabb. The story of Habil and Qabil, or if it's the story of Ashabul Kahf, or if it's the story of the two gardeners, or if it's the story of Musa alayhi salam or Isa alayhi salam, how Allah is dealing with people, is He telling us this is how He operates. When people do this, this is what Allah does. And this is how these people interact with Allah. Because you and I don't have the right to make assumptions about Allah. We cannot make assumptions about Allah. So let me just backtrack for a second. When a person says, I know Allah won't forgive me. I just know it. Allah won't forgive me. They've said something about Allah as if they know, right? And where did they get the confirmation for a fact that Allah won't forgive them? Oh, I just have a feeling. It's in my heart, I just know it. Really? You get revelation now? You get wahi that Allah won't forgive you? You and I don't get to speak on behalf of Allah and override how He speaks about Himself. Does He have something to say about this that overrides what you and I are thinking? So let's first take the scenario of sinful people. One of the most sinful people mentioned in the Quran, if not the most sinful person, would be Fir'aun. I often say, jokingly, but sounds pretty serious too, Shaitan would want his autograph. This guy is serious, right? I mean, if there's any crime that you can think of not of committing against Allah and against humanity, Fir'aun is your role model for evil, right? And Fir'aun, you would think, so many sins and so many murders and so much arrogance later, he should be at a point of no return. There's no way this person can be redeemed. There's no way this person should have a chance at forgiveness. This person should just be destroyed. That's all there should be. But when Allah sent Musa alayhi salam to Fir'aun, He didn't send Musa alayhi salam to Fir'aun to destroy Fir'aun, to punish Fir'aun. In fact, Allah sent him to Fir'aun to remind Fir'aun. And then He said there's potential he could actually maybe even be affected by this reminder, and he might even become a God-fearing person. لَعَلَّهُ يَذَّكَّرْ أَوْ أَنْ يَخْشَى. Now that's pretty wild. Because a person who's literally killed babies, who's enslaved entire nations, who's declared himself a god, who meets every check for, you know, highway to hell, if you check marks every category, this guy's the number one candidate for the kind of person who should be in hell. And Allah tells Musa alayhi salam, after all of those crimes and years of them, Allah tells Musa alayhi salam about this old man. By the way, Fir'aun is an old man. So it's not like, oh, he's young, he can change. No, he's lived a whole life of doing this stuff. And you know what we say about old people? They're set in their ways. It's too late for them. They are how they are. How can they ever change? And Allah tells Musa alayhi salam, even he, there's a possibility he can benefit from the reminder and he might become somebody fearful. Even though we know how the story turns out, these words are important, aren't they? Allah is telling us something not just about Fir'aun, but about human beings. You could have done and the kinds of sins, the kinds of bad, that it shakes you to even talk about it. Like you're so embarrassed by it, you can't even talk to another person about it. That's how bad it is what you did. That's how embarrassing it is. That's how humiliated you are, even inside yourself. You can't even, Shaitan's got you so good, you even have a hard time telling Allah, opening up to Allah about it. And even if you do, the moment you open up to Allah, you're like, I really did this? How can I even be talking to Allah? Why? I sound so stupid. Allah is not going to forgive me. Just look at what I've done. Look at what kind of person I am. And Allah Azza wa Jalla does not allow a human being to give up hope on themselves. He doesn't do that. He didn't even give that seal onto Fir'aun. He didn't do that. When people have a predisposition, they say, no, Allah won't forgive me. Then they open up the Quran and they only look for confirmation of their own wrong assumption. So they say, oh, Allah says about some people, their hearts are sealed. See, that must be me. He's talking about me because it says في قلوبهم مرضون or فطبع على قلوبهم ختم الله على قلوبهم. Allah put a seal on their heart. Allah sealed their heart. There's a lock on their heart. That's talking about me. See, my heart is locked. The amazing thing about the people whose hearts are locked in the Quran over and over, you know what Allah says? فَهُمْ لَا يَعْلَمُونَ فَهُمْ لَا يَفْقَهُونَ فَهُمْ لَا يَشْعُرُونَ. They don't even know. They don't even know their hearts are locked. They don't even know their hearts are sealed. So when you come to me and tell me, I know my heart is sealed, then you can't be from this category, because the people whose hearts are locked have no idea that their hearts are locked. That's what Allah says. So this self-deprecation, attacking yourself, hating yourself, putting yourself in this hellish category, this is all your... Allah didn't do this to you, you did this to yourself. And Allah's words, if you want to misuse them, you can justify that. But if you're honest with yourself and the word of Allah, then Allah did not seal your heart. The fact that you even feel bad is an indication that your heart isn't sealed. The fact that you even have remorse means your heart is still alive. Then there's the matter of, why would Allah forgive me though? I mean, like I said before, if you knew what I've done, there's no way Allah would forgive me. This is way too much. And what about all those people that I hurt? Even if I do good deeds now, on judgment day they're going to come, hey, ya Allah, that hajj this guy did, you know what he did to me the year before? I'll take the hajj credits. You know, and the other 30 Ramadans he had after that, I'll take all those fastings, because this guy robbed my business, he humiliated me, he ruined my reputation, he destroyed my family, he did this, she did this, I'll take all her good deeds, thank you very much. So this person's like, what's even the point of me doing any good deeds now? Because they're going to take it all anyway. Like, I'm stuck, there's no point. These are the kinds of thoughts Shaitan wants to plant in your head, he wants to close your path to even doing any good deeds. He wants to close that road. I want you to understand something. One of the worst things, if not the worst thing you can do to somebody, is kill them. And in the same story, Musa alayhi salam killed a person. فَوَكَزَهُ مُوسَى فَقَضَى عَلَيْهِ. He killed a person. I mean, if you're talking about violating another human being's rights, the ultimate right we have is the right to live. And he violates that right, alayhi salam. And when he does it, then even though there's lots of things to learn from that incident, just one thing. He wasn't even a prophet yet. The incident of Tur has not happened yet. He hasn't gone up to the mountain and have a word with none of that has happened yet. He's just a believer right now. He's a mu'min. But he's not a rasul yet. And when he does this, he says, Rabbi inni zalamtu nafsi faghfirli. My master, I have done wrong to myself. Before I get to the next part, I have done wrong to who? Myself. This is different from inni zalim. I'm a wrongdoer. I've done wrong to myself. This is a very important distinction. Because if you say inni zalim, you have identified yourself as a wrongdoer. This is who I am. This is my identity. I am a wrongdoer. But when I say I have done wrong to myself, you have identified an action. The action is bad. And that action's first victim, the victim was someone else, the guy who died. So you would think, Musa alayhi salam would say, Rabbi inni zalamtu ahadan. I wronged somebody else. That's my victim who's lying there dead. He says, Rabbi inni zalamtu nafsi. I've done wrong to myself. I've done wrong to myself. I've hurt myself with this sin. I'm also a victim of this sin in addition to the person I hurt. But he's concerned about that wrong that he's done to himself, and he turns to Allah and he says, Faghfirli. Forgive me. Now, by the way, Musa alayhi salam might not ever be able to get the forgiveness from that victim. That victim who got killed, right? He doesn't have a chance to say, I forgive you, or I don't forgive you. So, if we had that kind of anxiety, we'd say on judgment day, that victim's going to come after me, he's going to be like, yo, you killed me. I'm going to take all your deeds. Now you're going to hell. You can't be forgiven. You killed me. Hand me everything. What did Allah say when Musa alayhi salam said, forgive me? He said, فَغَفَرَ لَهُ. So he forgave him. Why is this important? Because even when you've wronged somebody else, even when you cheated somebody else, even when you hurt somebody else, on the one hand, we have to try to make things right. We'll talk about that in a second. But first and foremost, don't confuse that with Allah's forgiveness. Your forgiveness does not depend on another human being. It only depends on Allah. Your mother doesn't get to tell you, Allah will never forgive you, because she doesn't get an email from Allah telling her that you are going to hell. Your cousin doesn't get to tell you. Your uncle doesn't get to tell you. Your friend doesn't get to tell you. Somebody who hates you doesn't get to tell you, Allah will get you. They don't have that guarantee from Allah. And they don't also have the license to say, until I forgive you, I know Allah won't forgive you. That's not how Allah's forgiveness works. It's not dependent on another human being. We have to be very clear about this. I owe apologies to people I've done wrong. And if I'm not in a position to apologize, maybe I owe something else. Let me tell you about owing apology for a moment. I want to make this concept clear. Asking Allah's forgiveness, well, if you're sincere in asking Allah's forgiveness for the wrong you've done, even the wrong you've done to others, it does not depend on how they feel about you. They could still hate your guts, but Allah can still forgive you. Those are two separate things. But now let's talk about the people you hurt. Because the people you hurt might say, hey, why did Allah forgive them? That's not fair. They get to do all that and they get maghfirah. I don't like this deal. They should at least pay something. We believe in Allah's absolute justice. We believe in Allah's rahmah. I trust Allah's judgment more than I trust my own judgment. When you watch an episode of Judge Judy or something and you see the verdict, you're like, she was a little biased. We don't think like that about Allah. I don't worry that Allah will let some criminal off the hook or unfairly forgive someone or they deserve to get punished and I feel like justice wasn't done. I have this tawakkul in Allah's wisdom. I have this reliance on Allah's wisdom, His justice, His all knowledge. He knows things I can't possibly know. He understands things I can't possibly understand. And so when He makes that decision, I have to step back. I don't know. I can't say about anybody else. But now finally, so let's get to that before I wrap up today's khutbah. And that is, what about the people that you did wrong? What about them? I'm reminded of the case of Al-Wahshi. Al-Wahshi, for those of you who don't know, in the battle of Uhud, he threw the spear that killed the beloved uncle of Rasulullah ﷺ. Right? So he was paid to do so, and he was successful. And not only was he able to kill him, then the body of the Prophet's uncle was mutilated in this after the battle, right? So this is, but the cause of all of that is Al-Wahshi. Years pass by, Islam is victorious, Makkah has been conquered, and Al-Wahshi actually accepts Islam. He accepts Islam. And when he accepts Islam, we know that all your previous sins are forgiven. Now he wants to come meet the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But the Sahaba remember him. They remember him. If they see him even from a distance, they're not even going to ask questions. Because this guy's dangerous, right? He can throw a spear from a distance. He's going to get killed. So when people are coming in huge numbers to accept Islam and to meet with the Prophet, to give him bay'ah, to pledge their hand to him, and there's a line formed and people are coming and meeting, he cloaked his face to come to meet with Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. And he finally got to the point where he's right in front of the Prophet ﷺ. He removes his cloak, the Prophet recognizes him. Rasulullah ﷺ recognizes him. And when he recognizes that face, what memories are coming back to the Prophet ﷺ? What happened with his uncle? And he said, aren't you? And he said, yes, I am. Now it's too late for him to get killed, yeah? Because now he's in Aman, he's in safety. The Prophet asked him, how did you do it? What happened? He didn't want to say, but the Prophet made him tell him. He made him tell him. We know Allah has already guaranteed for any sins you have committed before. We know what happened with Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu ta'ala anhu. Others. Khalid ibn Walid killed, because of him, so many Sahaba got killed at Uhud. And he's one of our heroes. Why? Because once you accept Islam, previous sins are forgiven. This man killed someone the Prophet ﷺ deeply loved, and now he's accepted Islam. And after hearing that story, of course he's still forgiven, but the Prophet ﷺ told him, but I can't bear to see you. He couldn't see him. He moved far away somewhere. He couldn't look at him. In the end, Rasulullah ﷺ is also a human. And when he sees this man, he remembers the mutilated body of his beloved uncle. He remembers all of what happened. So it's hard for him to process that. You know what? While the Prophet ﷺ has accepted that this man is Muslim and his previous sin, including the murder of his uncle, is forgiven, that doesn't mean that he's over it. That doesn't mean that it still doesn't cause him pain. But you see how in our religion, those two things are separate? Somebody might still be hurt by what you did, but that doesn't mean that Allah hasn't forgiven you. Allah has forgiven you. Even if the one you hurt was Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, can you imagine? Even if that was the case. So we have to clean up our thoughts about how forgiveness works. We also have to realize from a story like this one, that if you really hurt somebody badly, you said a lot of bad things about them. You spread rumors about them. You humiliated them. You cheated them. You did all kinds of bad things to them. And their life became very difficult because of you, if that happened. And years later, you feel bad, right? And you don't want them coming after you on Judgment Day. So you decide to pick up the phone or call or show up at their house and ring the bell. Please don't ring that bell. Please don't make that phone call. Because that in itself can be an act of mercilessness. It may be just hearing your voice can trigger them again. It can cause, bring back all those bad memories. That might be a difficult thing for them. That's too selfish of you and me that we think we can just call somebody or face somebody and say, hey, sorry, you know that, you know those fingers of yours I chopped off? Sorry about that. I feel really bad. I realize now that that was wrong. Don't expect somebody to be so understanding. And put yourself in those shoes. If you saw a person like that, even if they said sorry, maybe you just want to stay away now. Maybe you don't want that person in your view. So out of rahmah to them, maybe, if there's room for reconciliation, that's something else. But our deen is about istinas. Like, you don't talk to somebody, you don't engage with somebody until you know that they'll feel good about it. This is not about how you're going to feel. This is about how they're going to feel. You've done it, you and I have done enough damage. So we don't have to put ourselves on them. Right? But if you find from other sources they're okay to talk to you, that's a different story. That's a different category altogether. Right? So this is what I wanted to dedicate this khutbah to, this concept. That, you know, رَبِّ إِنِّي ظَلَمْتُ نَفْسِي فَغْفِرْ لِي فَغَفَرَ لَهُ. Allah forgave him. Allah forgave him, even though the crime isn't against Allah, the crime is against a human being. So when we do wrong, when we seek Allah's forgiveness, if we fall into hopelessness, I know I said that's the last thing, but I forgot this and it's critical. If you don't get out of this hopelessness, if you find yourself in this situation and you don't get out of this hopelessness, then you know what's going to happen next? Two things. What's the point of me doing any good now anyway? I'm going to go to hell anyway. And I can't even live with myself. I don't even want to think about myself. I hate myself. And you hate yourself so much that you want to do an activity that makes you forget about everything. And you know what those activities are? Pretty much all of them are haram. Every one of them is haram. So you'll become addicted to evil activities only because that becomes an escape for you. That can become a very addictive escape because you can't live with yourself. I can't bear the thoughts, the memories, the burden of my previous sins. But Allah removed that burden from us because He gave us the door of tawbah. When your tawbah is sincere, your heart is resentful, you're full of shame, and you turn to Allah and you beg Allah to forgive, and you make a commitment to Allah that you will do your utmost best to never fall into that trap again, then it's over. Then you don't have to relive that sin over and over again. That's what shaitan would want you to do. Now it's time for you to do right. Replace that bad with good things instead. So I pray that Allah Azza wa Jalla helps us come out of that cycle of negativity, those of us that are suffering from it, and those of us that may be suffering from it silently. They haven't told anybody. They're too ashamed to tell anybody. Maybe these words can be of some benefit to them, that they can find that there's a way for them to come back to Allah and really find a way to honor themselves again. You know, Allah has honored human beings and shaitan wants to see us humiliated. And if Allah has honored human beings, just like I need to honor you and honor you and honor you, I also have to honor myself. It's not okay for me to humiliate myself either. Don't degrade yourself. May Allah Azza wa Jalla make us those who honor others and honor ourselves for what Allah has given us and allow us a way back to make healthy tawbah to Him. Barakallahu li wa lakum fil Qur'an al-Hakim wa nafa'ani wa iyyakum bil ayati wa dhikri al-Hakim. Alhamdulillahi wa kafa wa salatu wa salamu ala ibadihi alladhina astafa khususan ala afdalihim wa khatamin nabiyyin Muhammadin al-Amin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. قال الله عز وجل في كتابه الكريم بعد أن أقول أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما صليت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم في العالمين إنك حميد مجيد اللهم بارك على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما باركت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم في العالمين إنك حميد مجيد عباد الله رحمكم الله اتقوا الله إن الله يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر ولذكر الله أكبر والله يعلم ما تصنعون أقم الصلاة إن الصلاة كانت على المؤمنين كتابا